used to be called third biennial event of the science fair. It's part of a works in progress class with directors and actors where they're learning how to make theater out of all kinds of crazy things. We did what? Poetry, and we did math problems, and we did events and rituals and emergency procedures and unanswerable questions. And then the culmination is this incredible collaboration with major scientists across campus. This all started because Michael Dunn and I had a very funny conversation some years ago about how scientists and artists are the same. We create things, we wonder about things, and wouldn't it be great? And that's how it started. So we're really glad to be involved again and really happy that Michael's with us today. We also owe a huge thank you to Illuminations for sponsoring this, which lets us be able to have fun t-shirts and things of that sort. After the science fair, you're all invited outside for some food and conversation with the artists and the scientists. And we're going to turn it over now to the science fair.
Hey there, scientists! Welcome to the science fair! My name is Kelly Hope, and my project is on the Stevie Lab. Brought to you by Illuminations. Oh, every afternoon when the clock strikes two, they leave the Stevie Lab wondering what they'll do. They throw off their coats and leave their tests behind. And then they wait and wait and wait until their test is defined. You'll never see them down. They're the nicest kids in town. Every afternoon the machines are on.
Na 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 na.
And we know they're having fun because they're never young.
Na 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 na.
And they celebrate with their closest friends. There's no need to travel more because they're next to them. You better come on down and meet the nicest kids in town. Scientists who like to lead the way, and once a year they have a
conference day,
and it's exciting what they found. They're the seaweed scientists with the latest, greatest tech around. So every afternoon, come by the seaweed wing. They're all supportive friends with love and everything. They look at us, specifically ourselves. They're small and tough to look at, but they know it well. World renowned, they're the nicest
kids in town.
Roll call!
I'm Rachel. Jake. Wilfred. Cody.
Kevin.
Michelle.
And I'm Susanna.
They spend a lot of time with the nanopores. Their graduate found they're the
nicest kids in town.
They're the nicest, nicest. They're the nicest, nicest. They're the science-y scientists, the nicest kids in.
Kids in town! Woo!
We first went to the Seaweed Lab about 3 weeks ago. At first, I didn't really understand much about the science, but I got to know a lot of them, and they were very patient and kind. Here's what I learned.
Hi, I'm Jake. I'm a graduate student. My goal is to earn a lot of money, and I want to know what can we do with the science.
Hi, I'm Rachel. I'm a graduate student. My research consists of ionic transistors. I love Grey's Anatomy and salsa dancing.
Hi, I'm Cody. I'm a graduate student. I used to play football, and my goal is to detect a lot of cancer cells at once.
Hi, I'm Wilfred, and I'm also a graduate student. I'm from England, and I'm about to run a marathon.
Hi, I'm Rochelle, and I'm an undergraduate student. I want to create new technology for new discoveries, and I also want to better physics education and create equity for underrepresented minorities and women.
I'm Kabin. I'm an undergraduate student. I am also an international student. One of my favorite places in Irvine will have to be Aldrich Park. It's so beautiful.
Hi, I'm Susanna. I'm from and got my PhD in Poland, and I love supporting my students.
Right now I'm working on a lot of things, but I've been looking at cell membrane for over 15 years.
So now the Science Fair company will do a representation of Susanna's research on the cell membrane and nanopores. I hope I got the details right.
So I'm talking to the liver cell, and she says that she's not gonna let me in. And I'm like, what?
What? I don't understand though. Yours is just a one tiny ion. Like, why can't you get along with other cells?
I know, but I don't want her in my life.
Okay, fine. You know what? Let's just take a break now. There's a new club called The Cell. You wanna check it out?
Yeah, sure. I could use a break.
Come on. Krishna,
I'm with her.
Krishna.
You are one strong lipid bilayer.
Supla?
Yo, Gabba Gabba. All right. Well, I got a couple proteins. All right, Susanna, they're not letting me in.
What happens? They're
feeling right. I don't know. I just tell them to like let me in and they won't. Like, look, watch.
Supla.
Stop.
Oh, I see why. Because you're speaking a different language. That's why you cannot communicate with the cell. I wonder why. You know what, for now, I'm gonna use my super scientist power to open up the channel. Okay, let's go.
We made it work. On behalf of all of us at the Science Fair, we want to thank Susanna for all the work she does to support her graduate students and us in the drama department.
Thank you, Susanna!
I wonder what's next in the Science Fair!
Hi everyone, my name is David Reinkensmeyer, and welcome to the UCI Biorobotics Laboratory.
Today we are going to tell you about the work we do to help people by creating robotic and mechatronic devices that enhance human movement, motor learning, and rehabilitation.
Some of the people we aim to help have had spinal cord injuries, strokes, and other disabilities that have impaired their motor skills.
First, let's show you what happens when someone has a stroke.
Our brain is made of many pathways which send signals to the various body parts to complete a motion. Let's see what a healthy brain
That's me!
Looks like when it sends a message to the arm.
That's me!
To wave!
But now, when a blood vessel gets blocked in the brain and cells die, there is damage that prevents the message from being sent.
In this case, the brain must use other pathways which are unfamiliar and which take longer. Our machines are designed to help people practice these skills so they get better and faster at them.
Now, you might say,
hey, David, isn't that what physical therapy is for? Training people to redo physical activity after there's been an injury or impairment?
And I'd say you're right. But our work is designed to make these tasks easier, more fun, or more successful. When people have trouble completing these tasks, they get frustrated and don't have the motivation to complete them. So our work is designed to make them more achievable, so they see more success and are more likely to keep up their practice.
For example, our PAM/POGO, or pelvic assist manipulator, or pneumatically operated gait orthosis.
Which was featured in Dr. Dre's music video, I Need a Doctor.
helps assist people by helping them keep upright and aligned while walking on a treadmill.
I'm about to lose my mind. You've been gone for so long. I'm running out of time. I need a doctor. Call me a doctor. I need a doctor, doctor, to bring me back to life.
We also developed the T-Rex, or Therapy Wilmington Robotic Exoskeleton, an arm device that helps relieve the stress of gravity so that way the patient only has to focus on the movement of the arm, not also on supporting its weight.
Our machine can come in three varieties. The first is assist, which makes movement more manageable, but also doesn't help as much with rehabilitation.
The second one tracks and gives feedback, which provides the most accurate picture of where they are in their work.
The third kind augment this error and let patients know of their mistakes. Therefore, they must train harder, gaining more strength and mobility.
Since these larger machines require you to visit your doctor and make an appointment maybe 1 hour a week, we are developing smaller, portable, and more affordable technology so that people can have it in their homes to use whatever they want as often as possible for the most effective benefit.
The other element that makes our work really challenging is the largest variable factor in our research, human motivation.
Woo! Yeah!
This is massively difficult to keep track of and has a huge impact on how successful these machines are. So our goal is to make these as fun and rewarding as possible.
Which brings us to our most recent success, the music glove.
This is a device you wear on your hand while you watch Guitar Hero. And as the cues hit each of the four colors, you touch your thumbs to the corresponding fingers.
This way it's a game, it's fun, and you get to listen to music.
Andrew, why don't you wear the glove? But since your fingers are too small, let's zoom in and get a human-sized view of those fingers.
I'm the thumb.
I'm the pinky.
We're the rest of the fingers.
And we'll be the following cues. So like in Guitar Hero, the thumb will know which finger to go to.
Cue the music. Exactly what we hope our clients experience when they use our machines.
And thanks for coming to the Biorobotic Laboratory.
Wow, that rocks! I wonder what's next in the science fair!
Rachel is exploring.
Oh. Ow. Oh, look at this bug I found.
That's a weird looking fly.
It's called an antlion.
Rachel spends all her time in the warm Arizona sun.
Whoa, an assassin bug.
Hi-ya!
Hi-ya!
She loves insects, plants, and small animals.
Gecko, I love
very curious.
Oh, hi there, Rachel.
Hi there, Mr. Tarantula. Why do you have so much hair?
It's a defense mechanism.
Oh.
So, Rachel, what do you want to be when you grow up?
Well, I like music and science and math.
Rachel went on to do exceptionally well in her math and science courses.
She excelled in music and had a love of all woodwind instruments.
She also got accepted into a conservatory, but ultimately decided to pursue science.
My music teachers kept telling me that I had to pick one instrument to specialize in, and I thought that was stupid. But then I realized, I can always do music, but it's kind of hard to do science as a hobby. Nearly impossible.
After graduating high school at the age of 16, Rachel began studying chemistry at Arizona State University.
I had no idea what I wanted to do. As a kid, if you were smart and good at math and science, you were supposed to become a doctor. But I hated medicine. I chose chemistry because I love science, not because I knew what career I wanted.
Rachel soon discovered that university life was the one for her.
I had a lot of fun in undergrad and grad school.
Rachel was eager to study, learn, and grow, and took every opportunity she possibly could.
She worked in her first lab freshman year and has been doing research ever since.
Fun fact, Rachel actually played baritone sax in a band with fellow PhD students. They called themselves
Whoa!
We loved whales. I also quickly realized that being a scientist was a real job.
As opposed to?
I don't know, I guess I always thought it was a fake job, like being a ninja.
Yeah.
It was one of those jobs that was always in the movies, but wasn't actually in the real world. But I was wrong. Now, I have a BS in chemistry, a PhD in physical chemistry. I've done postdoctoral work at UC Berkeley, and have spent the last 14 years doing research of molecular biology and biochemistry here at UCI.
And that's how Rachel Martin, the curious little girl looking at bugs in Arizona, went on to become the successful scientist and researcher she is today.
What do you do now?
Well, I do all kinds of things. For example, a few years ago, my husband and I genomed a carnivorous plant for winter vacation. Relationship goals, am I right? Most of the time, I spend in my lab where my main research consists of NMR spectroscopy. I have a couple of huge spectrometers in my lab, like this one, which consists of
a giant magnet,
a large coil,
and a spinner.
I place a sample of proteins in the spinner, which you know, spins. Then I send a frequency into the proteins, which disrupts them on an atomic level. And as you can see, well, you can't really see, can you? Let's take a closer look. Now, normally the atoms are kind of all over the place. But the frequency I send in makes them all line up and spin around. Now, when I stop sending the frequency, the energy that's built up in the atoms has to be expelled somehow, right? So they send the frequency back to me. These sounds are sent to a computer as data. Now, I'm not interested in every single piece of data that's sent to the computer. Most of my work consists of figuring out which frequencies are the ones that actually tell us how these proteins work. So, once that work is done. Beep, 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 beep I spend my days lining up atoms and making them sing. What more could I want?
I hope you enjoyed that. The next skit we have for experiment is Out of This World!
In a solar system just like this one, lived a young boy named Paul Robertson. While most kids had their heads up in the clouds, Paul Robertson had his head up in the stars.
I'm in search of aliens. Well, actually, I'm in search of exoplanets, but in order to find those, you need to find a star with a large enough habitable zone.
There's a lot more technicalities and science involved out there. But in essence, the sole motivator that gets our young hero up every morning is the potential that there's life in the universe.
The first signs of life we'll probably find out there will probably be small, itty-bitty, tiny microorganisms. Smaller than me. Smaller than you, even. But don't worry, little buddy. I'm never gonna stop until I find you. I wonder where you are. Any planet that orbits a star that isn't our sun. But I'm not interested in all exoplanets, you see. I'm interested in the ones that are found in the habitable zone. Those are the ones that could possibly contain life. Basically, in order to be habitable, it needs to be a rocky planet, like the ones of our inner solar system.
So, why do Venus and Mars not have life on them? Aren't they rocky and close to the sun?
Yeah, but actually, let me show you. Pretend you're the sun.
Okay.
Now, Venus, can I have some assistance? So Venus is too close to the sun, therefore is too hot to sustain life or liquid water. Mars has the opposite problem. Mars is really cold, and therefore is too cold to contain life. Earth is just right in the middle, in the perfect place to have life. We call this the Goldilocks effect, because Earth is just right. These planets are actually a perfect example of what the habitable zone looks like.
Oh, that makes so much more sense now.
Think you can narrate my story now?
I think so.
So are you just looking for exoplanets now?
Well, I'm actually looking for a star. Exoplanets are far too small to see through its telescope, so we look for a star first.
While Paul was in graduate school, scientists thought they found this star. Gliese 581. This star system is pretty close to Earth, only 20.5 light years away. It's similar in size to our sun, and it seemed to have three exoplanets orbiting it. Those planets were found through their gravitational pull on the star. They weren't particularly exciting, they were too small. Now here's where things started getting tricky. A group of Swiss scientists.
We are the Swiss.
We are signed by Schweizer.
Found a fourth exoplanet orbiting around Gliese.
We found a fourth exoplanet.
Hold on a second!
Here's the thing, scientists don't always agree on everything.
In America, we have 5 exoplanets.
Impossible, there are only 4, you are wrong!
There's 5.
9!
Right here.
No!
Not 9, there's 5!
9!
No!
Have you heard about Gliese 581?
Huh? Oh, yeah, I have all the research right here. Who are you?
I'm you.
No, you're not. I'm me.
I'm you if you were dropped in a black hole and came out on the other side in another dimension, hungry for vengeance.
That makes no sense.
It's irrelevant. I'm here to help. The Swiss and the Americans have it all wrong. They've been analyzing Gliese 581 with calcium.
Calcium? Calcium emits a blue light. Gliese 581 is a very red star.
Exactly. You should double check their work. Using red light. You could use
hydrogen. Hydrogen detects red light, and therefore would give us an accurate reading on the exoplanets. Let me just do the research over here. Oh no.
What is it?
2 of the exoplanets they found, they don't exist. They're stellar noise.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Paul meant well when he published his research. He was very kind.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Nice.
Go back to your absolutely
excuse me. I was doing some research on Gliese 581 using hydrogen. I discovered that the exoplanets you found actually don't exist. They're stellar noise. They're obstructions in the visible light spectrum caused by either maybe solar flare or any other possibilities, really. I'm sorry, but facts are facts. You just gotta listen to what the stars tell you. You can't really have a favorite answer in science.
But this is what most people heard.
You call yourself scientists? All your work is wrong. You don't have PhDs, you have PhD-dums!
Who are you to even say that?
What? Oh. You are correct. Great work, Paul, for a grad student.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How could you do that? You just killed off 2 planets.
No.
Paul Robertson, you are a ruthless destroyer of worlds.
No, I...
Planet killer.
What?
Planet killer. Planet killer.
No.
I only wanted to find the planets. I didn't mean to kill them.
Here you go.
What's this?
Hate mail.
Do you think you'll be okay?
I have to be. This isn't about me, it's about something much bigger. My work is never done. Sure, I may have disproven the existence of 2 exoplanets.
You'll disprove many more through your life, kid.
Yeah, but there are still billions out there waiting to be found. I'm never going to stop looking for you.
What Paul Robertson didn't know was that out there in a solar system just like this one,
There was someone looking for him. Any questions?
So, the color of a butterfly's wings has something to do with the colors that they see?
Actually, a correlation has never been demonstrated between the color of a butterfly's wings and the colors they can see. That's precisely what I'm working on now. Biologists suspect there is, but there's no scientific evidence. Yes?
Is anyone else doing this work?
Yes, there are three labs in the world who are actively studying color vision behavior in butterflies. The others are in Japan and Sweden.
How long have you been studying butterflies, Dr. Briscoe?
Adriana, and over 30 years. Yes.
Why? I mean, sure, it's cool and all, why?
Why not?
Well, why heliconius butterflies?
Because these butterflies are super cool.
Sure. But
they are. Okay, let's take a trip to the happiest place on Earth, and you can see for yourselves.
Disneyland?
No.
Starbucks!
Okay.
No! The greenhouse? Follow me.
Alright.
Exactly. We know very little about how these butterflies experience life. They see colors we can't. Took you long enough. And look at human vision for a moment. We have rods and cones. Rods are for nighttime vision. Cones are for daytime vision. Exactly. Now, we have cone cells for blue, one for green, and one for red. The butterflies we're currently working with, the Heliconius aurato, have photoreceptor cells for blue, green, violet, red, and we think they can see UV. That's exactly what we're figuring out in this experiment.
Dope!
To the lab!
To the lab!
Woo! First, we need to set up our training arena. Molly, set up your two colored lights.
But, those are the same color.
To us they appear that way, but not to a creature that can see ultraviolet. Now, we train the butterflies.
Train the butterflies?
Train the butterflies!
In line, please! Now, we have placed some honey water as a reward at the light we want them to go toward. Then, we take our forceps to grab a butterfly by the wings and mimic its flight pattern, making sure it sees both lights, and then we place it at the correct one and hope it feeds.
Ah, it's feeding!
Yay! So we take note.
It's not feeding!
Give it a little help.
Unroll the proboscis.
Unrolling the proboscis!
It's feeding!
Yay! So, we do this with all the butterflies a few times a day for a week or so.
Okay.
Maybe we switch the lights to see that they are correlating with the correct tube, with the correct color, not the tube. We do this again for a few days. About the ones picking the correct tube.
All the females picked the correct tube.
And the ones not.
All the males just kind of, well, they didn't really know what was going on.
So, this means?
That the female butterflies both have and use photoreceptor cells for ultraviolet that the males do not.
Cool.
So you mean that female butterflies have a superpower that male butterflies don't?